Hey everyone, it's Travis with the National Wild Turkey Federation. Another night of advanced turkey tactics. Hey, we're in our second week talking about turkey hunting tactics from the advanced level. You know, turkey season is full swing. We've been talking about that for a long, long time. And, you know, we're all probably thinking, man, what could I have done to get that gobbler to come in? What else could I have tried? And that's what tonight's about. It's about different tactics. It's not just the basic tactics. You know, we've been fooling with turkeys now for several months, and, you know, different things are going on. Maybe versus hens, should I gobble? Should I switch my calls? That's what we're going to talk about tonight. And we got a really great guest with us, and I'm really excited about having him on. He is known throughout the turkey industry now. One of the top-notch callers that are out there, competition callers on the circuit right now, won numerous from the grand national level, world, local, all kinds of calling championships. And it's an honor to have Josh Grossenbacher with us tonight from Rolling Thunder Game Calls. Josh, how you doing, man?
Good. How are you, Travis? Thanks for having
doing
me.
Great. So you've been chasing turkeys, I see.
Yes, I have.
And, you know, it's, as I said, everybody, you know, it's that time of year. And with turkey season, you know, we're always excited about it. We're always excited about calling the birds. And of course, as we go throughout the season, I know, how many states have you been to so far since it opened up?
Ohio just opened here on Saturday, and it's my fourth state so far. And I've still got three or four more to go. So,
wow. And, you know, and that's, of course, here in the South, things are starting to slow down. Things are moving more towards the Midwest and the North. Still chasing those birds. I know I've talked to a lot of guys that are out in the area hunting Miriams and Rios. And of course, you know, New York State, Pennsylvania, New Hampshire, all up your way is in full swing in Ohio. You know, Josh, when it comes to turkey hunting, I know you hunt just about every day, right?
As much as possible, yeah. Trying to think. Yeah, for the most part.
Pretty much, you know, get out there in the morning. And, you know, you see things change with turkeys, is particularly with the way the gobbling activities, how they are with hens and, you know, how we approach that each year. You know, it's hard to sometimes determine when to call, what to do when it comes to these turkeys. And, you know, one of the things that I think about, you know, with what you're doing in your line of profession and how we do a lot chasing these turkeys. But you think about the birds you've chased this year and the situations. And, you know, tell everybody, you know, I think a lot of people think that gobbler's just going to, you go set up, he's going to bail out of that tree. Well, it's not true, is it? You know, he's going to come straight to you.
No. One of the toughest things I've experienced in a long time was we started off in Alabama the first 4 or 5 days of their season down there in March. And you talk about working gobblers right off the limb. Well, they weren't gobbling on the limb, and we knew they were there. There was so much sign and we were seeing them here and there, but man, they just weren't gobbling and off the limb, I should say, but we really weren't having any success until later in the afternoon, like 5:30 in the afternoon, we finally get them to gobble. And when they did gobble, they worked right in. So compared to a few other states like Missouri and Ohio here, I mean, they've been hammering on the limb and working really good right off the bat.
So, you know, we talk about birds off the limb, you know, a lot of times, you know, a certain situation that I've seen this year is, you know, you locate him, he's kind of gobbling on his own. Do you like to, you know, when you're locating these gobblers right out of the gate, do you kind of like when they gobble, or do you like it, or are you trying to get them to force them to gobble on the roost, or are you just trying to let them do it on their own before you set up on them?
If they're not doing it on their own, I like to get them to gobble. But then once I'm keyed into their location, I'm not going to keep owl hooting or whatever else I might try to do to get them to gobble. I'm just going to let them do it on their own, and I'm just going to work on trying to get as close as possible.
Yeah. So give me, can you give me a little run of what your normal, if he's on the limb and you're getting there kind of just from that level, what's kind of your routine to get him started if he's on the limb sitting there? And, you know, what's, can you give me a demonstration of what your calling sequence would be just to let him know you're there?
Yep. This actually, opening day here in Ohio, Saturday, this has been one of probably my most effective tactics, and it's just some soft yelps just before any other hens have started yelping or anything. And I just like to, I want to be the first one that he hears. And I just start with some real soft yelps. And if he responds to it, great. If not, I'll give it a minute or two, and I'll kind of build the intensity in it a little bit, the excitedness of it, just break into a little bit more rasp. And the other morning, on our opening morning, me and some buddies were out, and I started off with a few series of yelps like that, and instantly a hen started just firing back, just yelping, and she started getting real aggressive. I mean, instantly, as soon as she started doing that, saw her fly down. She flew down before that gobbler did, and it wasn't a minute later, he was on the ground, and I mean, she was just charging right straight to us, and he was right behind her, and luckily, I mean, he came right into range, and we were able to kill him. So
do you try to mimic her, Josh? I know in certain instances where I've been in that situation, if mimicking her, you know, she gets, seems to be on the track too, but you know, in that situation, were you trying to mimic what she was doing, or were you trying to be a little bit more aggressive than her?
Once she started firing back and was being aggressive, yeah, I was trying to do exactly what she was doing and trying to kick it up a little bit more, just getting a little bit more raspier and harsher and just call them back stronger. And yeah, it usually just seems to fire them up even more, especially the mood she seemed to be in.
Yeah. And I've seen that. I saw it this past Friday in the instance where, you know, the gobbler, and this is what I was going to ask you, you know, that they're on the ground, but doesn't seem like they're coming. He's kind of hanging back there. And, you know, you know, he's got that hen with him, but then from the situation we were in Friday, the hen wasn't there. He wanted to stay in one spot, but getting a little bit more aggressive with him, it seemed to break him and make him come. You know, if you were going to do that, let's say in a calling sequence, you've got a gobbler that's kind of hanging there for a few minutes. If you were going to get aggressive with him to kind of get him fired up and come, can you give us a demo of what you would do right there?
Yeah. Just basically going to start off hitting him with some clucks and some aggressive yelps, and then a few small sequence or series of cutting followed by some more yelping, and then just kind of calm it down and wait to see what he's going to do.
A little bit of a motivator, I guess you could call that. Get him motivated and get him what to do.
Yeah.
You know, here's a question we got just popped up. This is a good one from Richard. It says, what would you do with a gobbler with hens that is going away? Say this gobbler starts to follow these hens off. What, and you know, we've been faced with that. I had that situation today. What would you do in that scenario right there?
I'm going to try to use the terrain, whatever I can, to keep myself hidden from him and make a move. And hopefully I've got the area scouted out and have a pretty good idea where they might be wanting to head to, or just get around in the direction that they're going, try to get in front of them. And I will lay off on the call. And the more you call, it seems like the faster those hens drag those gobblers away in that situation. So I'm going to wait till if I can get around in front of them, I'm not going to call to them until I know that they're somewhat close and have an opportunity to call them that short little distance in.
Wow. Okay. That's, you know, I got to thinking about that when you're talking about that situation. Is there ever times that you feel like maybe I should just back out and try this guy another day?
Yeah. If he crosses a property line or something like that, you know?
Oh yeah.
Which here in Northeast Ohio, I mean, we got permission on some places and it's kind of small blocks and stuff. And there's a lot of people around here that don't allow hunting or whatever. And I mean, that's can be an issue.
So since I've got you and we're talking about getting into our calling, you know, you call in kind of on two different stages. You call on in the woods and in that environment, and then you're calling on the stage. Just, you know, for everybody that's out there listening to us tonight, do you use the same type when you call on the stage? Is that basically the same way you're calling in the woods?
Try to, but it's not as in the woods. It's not polished. I consider it pretty sloppy. Like when I'm cutting, trying to locate a gobbler in the woods, like it's so choppy and pitchy and the tones are constantly changing, which, some of it I don't think would ever score in a contest, but man, it makes the turkeys gobble, you know.
That's right. And you know that's, I think a lot of people, you know, they see you guys on stage and you are, I mean, it's phenomenal, and you yourself and several others that are out there, how well you've got that polished and down to your calling. But we all know, you know, there's been instances, you know, we've both been in as hunters been in the woods, and you hear this whole hen and you're going, my gosh, is that somebody? But her pitches and her tones are just, you know, if she was on the stage, she would score a five maybe, or between zero and five. So that's great. Hey, you know, thinking about your calling, when you get in a situation and let's say you've hunted a turkey several days and this same gobbler, you know, he's in the same woodlot, but it's not working out. When do you think it's time to switch calls or maybe use something different on him?
If he's not responding to it, or if he is and he's just kind of hanging in the same spot, I like to switch over to a glass or a slate call. I've always been more of a mouth call guy, so I might switch the mouth calls I've got to like maybe a heavier call where I can get some more deeper rasp out of a call. I don't know. It's also situational.
I think you're right. You know, it is situational. We got a little short video right here. I think it's working a turkey that, you know, kind of seemed to want to hang up. Run it. Patrick, show that little video real quick where we switched up calls. So what happened here is basically we yelped the turkey and switched to a gobble call or something like that. And it's like, you know, when I think no one turkey's the same. It's like you said, it's just each turkey is different and you're trying to read the gobble and think, okay, well, it's kind of like fishing. I threw a top water, nothing bit. Let me go pull one more out and see if he likes that one.
Right.
And being a mouth call guy, you know, like you said, it might be that nice soft stuff, but then you may have to get real nasty and yelp, get real raspy on a mouth call.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, more times than not, I like to kind of keep it softer and not get too obnoxious. But when you get those turkeys where you start, you know, pouring it to them with the aggressive cuts and yelps and they start really keying on it and gobbling good at it, it's hard to back away from that, especially if they're moving. But once they start getting closer, you know, you tone it back down. Those are
Here's another question that came in for us from Bruce Compton. Says, do you do purrs and light clucks to get him in the gun range? And I'm guess we're talking about finishing that bird. What's your normal route? As again, there's no normal routine because every turkey's different, but Can you talk about that? A little demonstration of your purrs and light clucks to get him in the gun range.
Yeah, I will. But more times than not anymore, something that I've learned over the past few years, hunting over decoys and hunting in like open timber where there's not a lot of cover, especially like here in Northeast Ohio right now, the foliage hasn't come in yet and the woods are just wide open. I try to keep it as soft as possible, and I'll cluck and purr some, but more times than not, it's just a real soft, light throaty yelp, especially when he's coming in, you know, 50, 60 yards and he's really cautious cause he's not seeing anything. Or if you do have a decoy and he's still a little bit cautious, this is what I was getting back to. They get cautious around those decoys, just a little. It's not much movement with my mouth or anything like that. And it's just a soft, content call that I felt gives them that confidence to just calm them down and let them know everything's all right. And they'll usually roll right in.
Man, and you're right. You know, sometimes I think, you know, they get up, you're right, with decoys, they get kind of panicky. They might give a couple of putts there real quick, but then, you know, that little subtle yelp kind of calm puts things back in perspective and calm. And that's a great technique. I think a lot of people may not understand, you know, I've seen and talked to guys that said, you know, he got up to my decoys, he got real nervous. And then he started to take off, and then I rushed the shot and I missed him, but not knowing to make that little subtle, you know, kind of calming call. You can see their demeanor change real quick and they'll calm right down and get back focused on those decoys. While we're talking about decoys real quick, I know you guys, you know, you use a lot of them. Do you use decoys in all your scenarios, or is it when do you use decoys? Let's just ask you that.
Field turkeys is be about the only time I really use them consistently. But to me, there's nothing better than being in the hardwoods and calling a gobbler up with no decoys, especially once the season's a little further along and the foliage is coming in and he's got to get in there and hunt for you. Those are my favorite.
Oh yeah. Making him look for you. You know, one of the things that I was going to ask you, Josh, was about in those situations, you know, when you start on a gobbler, you're only giving him enough calling to raise that interest and then kind of hushing to get him to start looking for you. You know, when you look at a gobbler and you start to call, you mentioned you're going to start out soft, but if you see, are you kind of taking his temperature and testing the waters a little bit with your calling?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I was telling somebody about it the other day. I mean, one of my favorite things is, you know, those gobblers, you might only run into a couple of them all season, if not any, but, when you do get the opportunity, those ones that just seem to answer everything that you're throwing at them. Like when they're acting like that and they're coming, like, I just like to just keep throwing it at them. And just, I mean, I love to call and I love to hear them gobble. And I mean, to me, that's one of the main reasons I love this so much. And I want to hear them gobble and I want to call to them. So just keep pouring it to them.
Oh yeah. It's like you said, you have to start, punching their ticket and really getting them to, you know, just when that ticket's punched and you can tell when they're firing back, and it is hard to hush. And I'm like, you know, the gobble is what it's all about. We got another question just popped up here. And I remember this from Ben Reams. It says, have you ever used drumming as a call, the spitting and drumming?
Yep. It was probably around 2009, 2010. Walt Gabbard from Mossy Oak and I were hunting in Tennessee, and we'd been on a big full fan gobbler that just had a beard about that long, and it had beard rot, but it come out and shot straight up, you know, and it was like brown or yellow on the end. It was real goofy looking, but he had a field full of hens, and we were on him 2 days in a row. And the one day he was about 60 yards out there. And I mean, I'm trying everything I could do. And finally, I just started just drumming at him. And I mean, just like that, instantly he turned and it just came straight down the tree line right to us.
Wow.
I mean, it's,
that, you know, that it, people don't think about that, you know, and do you think a lot of times, and if you had to give some advice to people out there calling, you know, a lot of people may be afraid to try the drumming, you know, with a bird that close, or try, you know, a different type of call. If you had to give some kind of advice, you know, it's it, when it comes to that, should people be afraid to try things?
No. That's one of the greatest things of turkey hunting. I mean, every day you can learn something new. And I guess from being fortunate enough to get and go and do it all the time, I mean, man, I'd hate for people to know half the noises we've made while we're out there trying different stuff. And I mean, that's the only way to learn. And once you learn or have those experiences, there's no greater teacher, I feel.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. It's just like, you know, the spitting and drumming, and that was a great question from Ben. You know, a lot of people probably wouldn't have thought that, you know, the bird's kind of there, but you started that spitting and drumming and that closed the deal. Or it's like using, you know, I carry a wing with me to imitate turkeys flying out of a tree, or, you know, they're on the limb up there in the mornings and just brushing it against it. And that turkey's firing back at that. He's thinking, you know, just that natural sound. You know, I think a lot of times people think the basic yelps and clucks, but when you start to learn and experiment, like you said, test the waters.
Yeah.
You're not going to learn unless you try something.
Yeah.
And you'll know real quick whether it'll work or not.
Yeah.
And
just,
again, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to refer to the, like scratching in the leaves, or just, you know, raking your hand through the leaves, acting, trying to sound like a hen walking. And I mean, more times than not, I mean, doing that and the turkeys just gobbling and closing the distance on that when they're just out of sight. It's all sorts tricks.
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. So do you, you know, we're looking at things, and I was thinking about another question that a lot of times comes up, and you're faced with, you know, this time of year, particularly where we are in our season here, we're getting late season. Turkeys have been fooled with a good bit, or called to, or hunted. And, you know, you're just starting out in Ohio, and I know you've been to states that's probably like that. But in certain situations, when do you think there's a time not to call, you know, not to call that turkey, or to stop calling to him?
I know a bird I hunted last year for about a week dealt with this. Like, I was trying everything that I possibly could, and had him close one day and couldn't get a shot. But then he was kind of, I don't want to say he was on to me, but he just wasn't coming and doing the same thing. So I had to go in and get as tight as I could. And I didn't call, and I ended up killing him. Just, he was kind of in his same little pattern. But I knew if I would have called to him, he probably would have hung up and not come through there.
Yeah. And, you know, and a lot of times, do you think, Josh, you know, like you said, you and I both love to hear him gobble. And if he's really ripping the seams out of it, you know, you kind of keep him coming in and keeping him on that string. It's like you've set the hook and you just keep reeling and he keeps coming. But in certain situations, you know, do you think it's better to give him enough to raise his interest and then go silent to close the deal?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I like to kind of get in his head that way. Just get him gobbling, and then, you know, he's going to stand over there and gobble and expect me to come to him. But I think just playing that game with him and just shutting down and letting his interest peak, and then get him to where he's had enough and he needs to come see what's going on.
Right. What about, you know, in certain situations, particularly early, and it might be going on in Ohio, you know, where you're faced with maybe multiple gobblers out there, you know, groups of gobblers still together. Do you use a different tactic of calling, particularly in your hen calling, for when you're faced with multiple gobblers? Or is it the same as if you're, and I know we've talked about no one's the same, but when we start looking at two or three birds in the same group coming in, what's your calling sequence for that? Just dependent?
If there are three gobblers together and no hens with them, I'm gonna work them the same as I would if they were together. But in that situation, they're probably gonna be a little aggressive from stuff that I've seen in the past, and I will go to, like, trying to gobble at them. got three gobblers that we're going after in the morning that we drove by this morning, and two of them were chasing the one all over the field. And we just acquired permission this evening. And if I have to, I'm going to try gobbling at them, whatever it takes to get their interest, because they're so aggressive right now.
And you just answered my next question. I was going to ask you, you know, about gobbling at turkeys. When is there a time to gobble at turkeys? You know, when they're in that aggressive mode, like you're talking about, you know, and a lot of times, if you notice in switching calls, that's what I did there. This bird wasn't moving, and I was thinking, okay, I've done this, I've done that, but let's make him think another gobbler showed up to this hen to see if it'll make him move. But, you know, when to gobble, is it something that you would use? You know, I think a lot of times people use it as a last resort or the last kind of deal to maybe see if we can make this turkey move. Is that something you do, particularly with a gobbler and a hen that you're working? Would you gobble at him?
Oh, yeah. Just like we talked about with the drumming. I mean, you can't be afraid to not try it. trying to think. Well, Kansas the other day, we had two gobblers, kind of the same situation as I was just explaining what I saw this morning here. Two big gobblers chasing one around, and I got to yelping and then throwing in some gobbles that on a mouth call are absolutely hideous. But every time I did it, they gobbled. And finally, I mean, the whole situation changed, and they turned and came running into us, and we were able to get one of them. So you can't be afraid to try it.
Here's a question, Josh. It says, if coyotes continue to run in on calling, how would you combat that on the fly to keep that gobbler coming?
I guess wave my hands or try to get him to see me and scare him off and hope he doesn't spook the gobbler. I hate situations like that. And love to kill a coyote, but I don't want to ruin a hunt. That's for sure.
That's right. And, you know, there again, that would lead me to another question. Just because you maybe you're going into an area, I know we had this happen this year here where we heard a bird gobbling, and, you know, we were trying to make our setup and get to the bird and set up where I thought we were would be in his comfort zone, but the bird wasn't gobbling. And, you know, we eased up, bumped the bird, but he didn't run. He kind of waddled off and then reset, and the bird actually answered. You know, in those situations, if you bump one, know you haven't bumped him hard, are you going to try to relocate and maybe call that turkey up? Or
yeah, I would definitely give it a little bit of time, let him settle down. But I mean, there's no reason if he's not spooked bad why he shouldn't open back up within next hour or two, for sure. I would.
In your situations, when we're talking about the gobblers, do you think there's a time that, you know, and with your calling and getting into learning different calls, particularly Jake, you know, the Jake yelps or Jake gobbler yelps or clucks, do you, when you're incorporating that into a situation like where you're gobbling and with these aggressive gobblers or fighting purrs, you know, when do you see there's a time to implement that type of calling?
Definitely in the early season, it seems like those gobblers are still wadded up and still some places, you know, still trying to establish that pecking order. Yeah, right now around here, I would definitely try fights, and I'll try it throughout the season too, if nothing else is working, just to try to spark some interest.
Do you do that with a mouth call, Josh? Can you give us a little demo of your fighting sequence?
Yeah. Hold on, my mouth is bone dry.
No part worries.
And then some gobbler yelps. And Another situation like Jake Yelps, Gobbler Yelps. There was we were working a bird the other day, gobbling good in Missouri, and there'd be a little sequence of time where you didn't know where he was at, but every now and again you'd hear a Jake just gawk, 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 gawk. And you know how they'll do that when they're around a strutter. So obviously they were with a strutting gobbler and kind of giving him up in that that regard. We tried gobbling and Jake yelping and all that stuff, and ended up keeping him around enough long enough for him to work in. So
yeah, you almost sometimes you know, it's like you're working that turkey and you think, God, I don't hear him anymore. You're trying to listen for spitting and drumming. And then all of a sudden you hear that old Jake kind of, you know, honoring him with that old calking, that cow, 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 cow. And every time he struts, you can hear it. So, well, he's coming. He's getting close. Another question here from Ben. It says, what's the oddest sound you've ever heard a turkey gobble to? That's a good one.
J.R. Lanham, one of our guys that competes at the Grand Nationals and everywhere in all the other contests, he likes to make all sorts of racket. And hunting with him over the years, he has shown me this call that he likes to do that it is absolutely ridiculous. And I'll try to do it for you. Okay. But I mean, it sounds like a fire truck going down the road. It starts off, it almost sounds like he's trying to do a Kiki run. And then it just blows into the loudest, shriekiest, just obnoxious racket. But every time he does it, like when we're hunting in the Ozarks and stuff, that sound, it echoes for 5 minutes through the mountains and turkeys gobble. And he's like, I told you. And it's, if you want me to try to do it, I'll do it. But
sure, go ahead. Yeah. I'm sure everybody would love to hear it. You'll have everybody trying this tomorrow.
No lie, I mean. But he drags it on for another 10 seconds, and it is obnoxious, but it works. And I've heard lots of turkeys gobble to that.
That's great. You know, some of the weirdest sounds that are out there, you know, every little noise in the world that you'd think a turkey would gobble at. Earlier this year, we had a youth hunt at the Federation, and it was something that you may have heard this. We had a hen decoy out, and the gobblers were gobbling and was just really trying. And then a hen fires up and starts yelping, coming like we were talking about working her to us. But then it was almost like the sound of a tomcat meowing, and it was just really weird. I wish I had it recorded. I don't have a mouth call to even come close to even getting to it. But it was, if you've heard like tomcats that give this kind of row, it was the hen with some kind of aggressive purr whine mixed together coming up to that decoy, and it was almost like a cat meowing. So that's getting real close. But if you added that meow. Yep, that was it, and she came beelining it to us.
You hear chickens do that a lot too, make a sound similar to that.
Absolutely. Well, you know, again, Josh, it's all, I think one of the things you mentioned tonight, it's no one turkey's the same, and not being able to bring a fray to try something new. And I know you hunt turkeys all over the place, up and around, and you see different situations. Is there one so far? I know you've already hunted this year. Is there one particular situation this year, or a calling, what it took a stubborn gobbler that you had this year, and what did it take? What did you have to do to get that stubborn bird to come in? Is there anyone this year, or they all just ran right to you?
Give me one second here.
Okay. Yeah, I know you're kind of revisiting this year. It may have been last year, but, you know, just for reasons and letting people know, I would love to know that certain situation, because we all share thoughts and our experiences with everybody. Well, this gobbler did that, but is there one in particular this year?
This year, not yet. trying to think. Just some instances in the past, some tough turkeys that we've actually kind of done some like float calling or whatever you want to call it, where you've got one hunter up in front and the other one kind of works off, kind of trying to keep the shooter in between the caller and the gobbler and working away from them, trying to drag that gobbler in past the shooter. Had that work quite a bit of times, you know, when all else fails and just trying to do something. That's the one that sticks out most to me.
And that was what I was going to ask you. When you're in situations where you're hunting with a partner, you know, I know you hunt a lot with different folks and other team members from Rolling Thunder. You know, do y'all, when you're working a turkey, do you try to sound like a group of hens together and kind of mimic each other? Or is it just one of you calling? Or you know, what determines where both of you kind of chime in together and work it as a group of hens?
Yeah. We'll try to say Hunter Wallace is calling, and then as soon as he'll end a sequence or a series of calling, I'll fire back at him with a fast series of cutting, like an excited hen responded to him. There was a day last week in the snow in Missouri, Hunter and J.R. Lanham and myself were hunting with we had a couple youth hunters in that snow, and all three of us were kind of talking back and forth, and it really seemed to work. We had a group of gobblers get all fired up and come running in. It was pretty neat when you get to do that.
Yeah, it is, you know, and there is situations I know, but I've been in, and like you said, you kind of work each other. You kind of play off the other. It's kind of like being in the duck blind, you know, one's quacking or when then one's feed calling, same for sequence here. And, you know, again, goes back to maybe one person's hen yelping and somebody gobbles that's sitting there right back at it.
Exactly. Yeah,
so
I don't know if it really gives you a huge advantage, but I can't see how it would hurt you, you know.
That's right. Here's a question. So tell me, please, it says when you've got a bird gobbling, he's gobbling good, but he doesn't once answer you and is totally uninterested. What do you do? I guess, okay, so, but he does, all right, he's gobbling, the bird's gobbling, and he's gobbling good, but he doesn't answer you and is totally uninterested. What do you do?
Okay, that would be like a perfect case scenario to try other calls in your vest. You know, go to a glass call, slate call, box call, tube call, trumpet call. Something that's what I would try to do if he's not answering my mouth calls. And if he seems totally uninterested in all that and he's not answering any of that, I'm leaving and I'm going to go try to find another one.
That's right. And do you think in the early season, Josh, you know, particularly where you guys are, and I know you have certain tracts of land and we've talked about that here, and a lot of people might not understand, you know, it's early. And you see that a lot. He's gobbling on the roost, gobbling on the red. I mean, he's gobbling at anything that makes a noise, hits the ground and dead silence, like you threw the switch off. Do you think that this is the time to put, it's early or even in the season, he's not answering you, but do you think you test the waters or you try to force this turkey into answering and working, or do you come back another day? What's your advice on that?
I'll be aggressive and try to do whatever I can while he's there and get as close as possible without bumping him, you know. Situations more times than not that, I mean, like what you're explaining, they're usually penned up pretty good. And that those are hard situations to do anything with other than get sneaky and get in on them tight, you know.
Yeah, and then that goes to – what you'd say is you got to work those hens and get those to you. Do you see in that situation using fall tactics, kikiing and things like that to work those hens? Or if you're going to work a hen to you, are you going to start out aggressive? Or are you going to be kind of just testing the waters with her to work those hens?
Yeah, I'll take her temperature. I'll start soft and build into it. And then if she's not responding to that, try to get her fired up. it's a great scenario when it works out and you can get them fired up, because it can change the whole situation just like that. I'm trying to think. Kiki's. I'll try it every now and again, whistling, just to change up the tone and paint a different picture. And sometimes that'll jerk a gobble out of one or something.
Oh, absolutely. It goes back. Here's a good one from Helen. It says, I heard you say a guy rushed a shot and missed when the gobbler was curious about the decoy. It says, if you rush a shot and miss, how long should you wait before you visit that bird or spot again, or just not go back? Or do you try to fire him back up and call? That's a great question, Helen. What do you think there, Josh?
Depends on the bird. I wouldn't be afraid to go back in after him the next day. I would probably rather give him, a couple days to calm down, but he's probably not going to come right back into your decoys the next day. That's for sure. But I mean, he's still a turkey and he's going to do his thing if he's not hurt.
Oh yeah. And Helen, just, and Josh, I saw this last year on a youth hunt, on the youth season here. We, picture book, storybook, off the roost, came in very aggressive. Goblin ran into the decoys. Young guy misses again. Bird takes off down, and of course we let things calm down, reevaluate, assure him that, hey, it's all right to miss that turkey. Yeah. And we move down the road probably a couple hundred yards. And to this day, I still think we struck him again. He gobbles and fires back maybe 30 minutes later. He comes in, but he's less aggressive. He's kind of shying away, kind of checking things out. And it might have been good to come back another day on him. It's, again, testing the waters and see what he wanted to do.
Like, I've seen situations like just the other day, we had three come in, and those two young boys, they each killed one of them. The other one stood around. Okay, he just heard those guns crack. He stood around. Well, until we jumped up and run out there, but he dang near had to run him off. But he heard the shots go off, so he was right there. I mean, he wasn't scared, or he would have been one to work later that day for sure.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
So I think that just depends on the turkey.
That's right. Well, Josh, just real, kind of to recap, I know we've been going at it here for a while. Just kind of, any last thoughts when it comes to, getting into more of advanced calling to birds or situations? Is there any advice you could give somebody to, after what we kind of talked about tonight?
Practice. Don't be afraid to try different calls. There's so many different styles of cuts, reed configurations on the market today. And just know that there's not everyone's going to work for you. It's mouth calls are frustrating. Don't give up. You just got to work at it. If you can get on YouTube, listen to Real Turkeys, practice listening to that. There's numerous CDs online for sale that have turkey calling. I've got an old, I've got Spit and Feathers and Treetop Turkeys in my truck that I listen to nonstop. My daughter hates it. Just as far as mouth calling and any calls for that matter, I mean, you just got to practice. And the more you practice, the more confidence you're going to gain. And when you get in those situations in the woods, it's going to be second nature when it comes to making those sounds. And confidence is deadly.
Yep. Hey, we got one more last question before we let you go here. It says, what do you do when a gobbler is hung up on a large obstacle like a river or a large creek?
Depending on the size of the river, I mean, I've gotten wet numerous times chasing after them. But I've also grown older and wiser and kind of had gotten a little more patient, and we'll give them a little bit of time and see if they will fly across. I don't know. That is,
I've seen them do it. I've seen them, a turkey's never going to cross the fence. He's not going to cross the ditch. He's not going to cross the river. I've visually seen that. Now I may, like you said, call and then back up away from it.
Yep. Act like you're leaving him.
Yeah. And he'll come across. And then there's days that he'll stay over there and go back and forth, back and forth. And it's like you mentioned early, you know, it's just whatever mood he's in for that day and what he's going to do.
I've seen in West Virginia hunting down there in the big mountains, you hear a turkey answering you way across the big hollow there. And it's like, boy, we're never going to meet up today. And the next thing you know, you hear him flying. He's gobbling 100 yards below you.
That's right. Oh, yeah. One of my West Virginia experiences was just like that. We were standing on one mountain and he's over on the other mountain. Next thing you know, where it's a race for us to try to get closer and he's beating us there. It's just, you know, whatever he wants to do. And that's a great question because I know, you know, the textbook says, nope, they'll never cross the river. They'll never cross. Well, if they want to come, they're going to come. It doesn't matter what's going on. So, hey, you know, Josh, we really appreciate you being on here. And folks, if you want to reach out, you're talking about good calls. Hey, we've got the Rolling Thunder Game Calls website. We're going to post. Josh is with them and with their pro staff. You know, reach out and check them out at Rolling Thunder. Josh's signature line of mouth calls are there. And if you've never used one, I promise you, you want to practice with it. It's a great sounding call. Josh, man, again, we really appreciate you coming on tonight and sharing some of your knowledge and wish you the best in the turkey woods this year.
Thank you. You too. And good luck to everybody else out there.
Josh, thank you again, man.
Thank you.
Hey, that was some great information from Josh. You know, we're talking about different things for turkey hunting, and Josh went over a lot of good calling tactics, and he showed us how, you know, to run these mouth calls and scenarios you use. But there are different things out there that are from a turkey calling aspect. You know, there's the wing bone calls that, you know, you can make yourself that are made from the wing bone that are basically a turkey call. It's a different type of call. You know, Josh talked about changing up. Changing calls. You know, a lot of times, you know, I know a lot of guys, this is all they use is a wing bone call. And it's basically you're basically losing a straw. I'm not the best at a wing bone, so I'm not going to demonstrate it. And then, you know, there's another one out there that's becoming more and more popular. And another world renowned caller that's gotten and won a lot of calling championships is Mark Prudhomme. And Mark couldn't be with us tonight, but he is in the trumpet call. And Mark has some really good advice on using trumpets. And trumpets is a different sound. It's a different call. And, if you're out there this time of year and you're chasing gobblers around and you've used mouth calls and you use a box and you've used a slate, you know, there's trumpets. Don't be afraid to switch up. Matt, learning how to use a trumpet and how that trumpet sounds is a different sound, just like that wing bone call that you might use, and it sounds different and it sounds like a different turkey, and that might help you to get that bird to come in. So we've got a little video from Mark Prudhomme talking about using a trumpet call, particularly in a situation where you're calling in a gobbler.
A lot of people ask me, how do you finish a turkey running a trumpet? You know, a lot of times you run a trumpet with two hands. I don't wear any gloves, so I want to try to keep my hand movement to a minimum. I don't think that not wearing gloves hurts you as long as you don't move your hands much. So what I do is I've learned to call, and I keep the call in my right hand. Everybody's different. Some people like to do it different, but this is what works for me. But I keep my call on a short lanyard, so it's near my mouth all the time. And I got my gun up, and if I need to just do a little bit of something just to kind of get that bird an extra few yards, I got it right here. I'll keep the call in my mouth. I'll put it in my mouth where and kind of bite down on the lip stop And that way, if I need to call again, all I got to do is roll my hand back under and I can do it again. And if I'm about to shoot and the bird's in range, I'll drop it. I keep it on a short lanyard so it doesn't drop and fall too far, kind of like this. That'll keep your movement to a minimum, keeps your hand close, call close, just in case, and that's what works for me.
Hey, some great about trumpet calls. More and more people are starting to use those, and we'll try to get Mark's information up on our page so you can contact him if you're interested in trumpet calls. We have more of those learn to how to with the trumpet call at nwtftv.org, or you can go to YouTube and look that up on how to run a trumpet call. You know, one other thing that's out there that people probably don't think about, and it's tube calls. And the tube call is really what I got started. And, you know, a tube call, you can gobble on it. I think we got a little short video with it, with the tube call. But a tube call is basically a piece of latex. When I first started out, this is like an old snuff can, or it was called a snuff can, made from a snuff can. Probably one of the first calls that I ever called my first turkey up was with a tube call. And, you know, they're made so many different ways. They're made like a clarinet end, or they have kind of a flat end to them with a piece of latex. They're long, they can be short. You know, the tube calls out there nowadays are so different, and they have a pop on, and there's so much you can do with a tube call. You can cluck, you can gobble, as a different call, you know, the little shorter ones, you can yelp. Great little call here. I mean, just a tube call, you know, and it's a different sound. You know, a lot of turkeys get out there and get used to hearing, you know, a mouth call or a box, but you can take a little tube call and go out there and you can basically just do these nice soft yelps. Add a few gobbles. And that's a tube call. You know, there's all kinds of calls out there to change up your sequence, be something different. You know, we talked about it with Josh. It's about, you know, just like fishing. You know, one day might be a rubber worm. One day it might be a box call. One day it might be that trumpet or the wing bone, and you may have to break out your tube call. Hey, don't be afraid to try and master these other calls. As Josh said, practice, practice, practice. And adding these other calls, the trumpets, the wing bones, tube calls, is always a good one. Travis Gowans is definitely going to make me a tube call. Totally different sound. Absolutely, man. And you can make them. I remember making them out of 35 millimeter film canisters, which nobody uses now, or a pill bottle. And again, the original one, and this is a Quaker Boy snuff can. If you remember the old days of dental snuff, that's what it was. That I first started out with, made by Penswood. So it's definitely something that I keep in my repertoire or in my arsenal is a tube call. And it was the first turkey I ever called up was with a tube call. So, hey, great stuff there. Hey, guys, it's been a great night. I really appreciate Josh coming on. I appreciate Mark Prudhomme and his video talking about trumpet calls and getting a little bit more in advanced calling in certain situations. Hey, if you're not an NWTF member, I would encourage you to join. It's a great organization. We're out there to preserve conservation and hunting heritage. And what all your money goes directly to preserve that and to have these great videos and lives that we have hey, join us now. Join the greatest conservation organization out there for wild turkeys and our hunting heritage. Hey, guys, next week, bam, we're coming at you again. We're going to talk about advanced turkey hunting tactics. We're talking about scouting and planning a trip. That's next Thursday, May 4th at 7 p.m. We're going to have a really special guest on for next week. This guy has been hunting all over, and I'm not going to give it away, but he just achieved a major, major goal in accomplishing harvesting turkeys in 49 states. Hey, it's one of our big partners here at NWTF. Look forward to seeing you guys next week. Hey, enjoy the spring season. Get out there and share the experience with someone who's never done it before. It's all about the gobble. See you next week at Tuesday here at Advanced Turkey Tactics. Be safe.